Okay. So again, please do not hesitate to ask questions or tell me that certain parts are not very clear and so on. And okay, we yes.
Just what about talking about local times? It's quite intuitively right. It's the same thing. You're right. That's both integrals. But what I do not get is what is the advantage for using local integral time?
Yes. So, okay, very good. And this is very much at the core of what I am going to discuss now. That is this identity, which is called the occupation density formula, is writing a quantity which is presented to you purely in time fashion into a quantity which is presented to you now in a space fashion. Okay, so you are transferring from time to space. And what I would like to explain now also is that there are many properties of Brownian motion, such as the Markov property, which is also transferring from time to space. So of course we have to be careful. I mean, this is not a very general statement, but if you choose the time at which you are looking the local times in the space variable, it may happen that it is that this process indexed by space is Markovian. Okay, so many such properties are absolutely astonishing when you see them first. This transfer, okay, which is occurring, and this is the content of the Reinheit theorems. In fact, the Reinheit theorems tell us precisely what kind of Markov process is occurring at this point. Okay, so this is part two. So Reinheit theorems. Reinheit theorems. Sieselski-Taylor identities. So I will focus very much, I mean, not entirely, but the end of this part two will be really to try to explain the Sieselski-Taylor identities via the Reinheit theorems. And as you will see, this is a part of what I call the coincidences. But in between, there will be also further coincidences which have been noticed by physicists. Okay. So, following on your question, let me write again the occupation time formula. Okay, so I write it for every function again. So for every f from R into R plus Borel, integral 0 to t ds f of bs. Okay, so that is this quantity. If f is the indicator of gamma, this is the time spent in gamma by Brownian motion up to time t. This quantity you can write, in fact, as an integral dA f of a. And now you have a density of occupation, which is called also the Brownian local times. Okay. Now, the Reinheit theorems. So Reinheit theorems tell us about the Markov property, about the Markov property of LA. But when taken, in fact, it's very easy to remember. You somehow you get into a terrible situation if, at the time you are looking at the local times, Brownian motion is not fixed. So, well, you'd better look at times when Brownian motion is fixed. So the Reinheit theorems really, in fact, tell us about the law of LAT1. Okay, so A smaller than or equal to 1, where T1 is the first hitting time of 1 by Brownian motion. Okay, and also LA tau L, A in R, where tau L is the so-called inverse local time, so inf of t at which L0t is bigger than L. Okay. Again, Here, of course, I could have taken TB, okay? And here, I could have taken the inverse of local time at, let us say, level B, okay? But, it's by scaling, translation invariance, etc. What I am going to say right now can be extended to TB and tau BL and so on. Okay. So what? So let me write again the occupation formula here. Nothing new, of course. But so this is integral from minus infinity to 1, okay, because up to T1, Brownian motion was always below level 1, so there is no local time after above level 1, or these local times are identically 0, so dA f of A LA T1. Okay, now what Ray and Knight separately in 1963 obtained is that LAT1 is a Markov process, and more than that, they can describe this Markov process in a very beautiful way. So L, in fact, well, it is better to look at the local times from level 1 downwards, and when X is between 0 and 1, this is distributed as, okay, an object we have seen before, X squared plus Y X squared, okay, X between 0 and 1. So we take the norm squared of two-dimensional Brownian motion, okay? So this is called the square of two-dimensional Bessel process also. And then, what about the negative side? Okay, so this is telling us, maybe I should draw a little picture. We have level 1, Brownian motion has been doing something like this, and finally arrived to level 1 at time t1. And we are looking at the time, or the infinitesimal time, it has spent in levels, okay, at given levels, okay. So something, okay. So and each time I try to evaluate the time it has spent there, and so in fact, very traditionally, we draw this curve, the local time curve, okay. So it's something like this. And you arrive at here, okay, and then let us say this is little L, and so on the negative side, conditionally on L0 T1 equals little L, we can describe the local times on the negative side. So let us say L minus X T1 X greater than or equal to 0 is distributed. In fact, this is a martingale which has a finite lifetime. Okay, is distributed as, and very often people call this the failure process, because this is a process which occurs with population genetics and so on. I don't want to call it dzx equals twice square root of zx d beta x. Okay, so it's, you have a stochastic differential equation here, and z0 equals little a. Okay, it is also called the square of zero-dimensional Bessel process. But anyway, I don't want to discuss this too much. All I want to say is that this process LAT1 is Markov, and its law can be described in a very precise way, which in fact is extremely interesting in connection with the distribution which Rod was talking about throughout this.
Mark, These identities in distribution do not tell you that it is Markov, right? That the Markov property comes from somewhere else, from a deeper reason.
No. The Bessel process or squared Bessel process is Markov. Okay.
Sure. And so it is distributed as a stochastic process.
As a stochastic process. These are all as stochastic processes. Okay. So when I write like this, it means that I consider the full process. Okay.
Yeah. And then the other question is the second process. Can you actually say that it is a diffusion?
Yes. It is a continuous Markov process, and it is also a martingale. You see what happens here is that you accumulate some time, and when you arrive here at the minimum, then there is no more local time. Okay. So. Okay, let me maybe just write it like this. Zx is another Brownian motion, beta tilde, which starts from L and is time changed with 4 times integral from 0 to x of zy dy. But again, and this is one of the difficulties in the Dickey-Fuller quantity, beta tilde and z are not independent. So anyway, there are these results, very beautiful and celebrated Reinhardt theorems. I should give you also this result here because it is very closely related to this presentation of the local times below level zero in this situation. So L A tau L, so you fix L and you have accumulated little L units of local time at zero. L A tau L, A greater than or equal to zero, and L minus A tau L, A greater than or equal to zero, are independent and are distributed exactly in the same way as here, okay? As, okay, base squared, so we call this often base squared zero with dimension zero starting at little l, okay? So this is, again, the same process which comes in when you want to describe the time spent positive up to tau n and time spent negative up to tau n. Some of you have attended my lecture on Monday, okay, and we were interested in the time spent positive, okay, integral from zero to tau n of ds indicator bs positive, and the time spent negative. And we can write this as, okay, integral zero to infinity, dA, LA tau L, and also on the negative side. And we see from this description that we have two independent random variables, which are in fact stable one-half. So I discussed about this, and this is a way of getting at the arcsine law for the time spent positive by Brownian motion. But this, okay, so this was the topic of my discussion of my lecture on Monday. As I said, this part two will be really about these coincidences, and I would like to give from here the Laplace transform of the time spent, let us say, positive and negative up to T1 by Brownian motion, and also the local time at zero. And you will see, again, that we get quantities which are very much reminiscent of Levy's earlier formula. Okay. But we understand why, I mean, I have just told you about the Reinhardt theorems, and now we understand why we get such closely related formulae. Okay? So you will find in the literature, in particular, as Rod was very kind to mention many times, the literature on Brownian windings or asymptotics of Brownian windings. This Laplace transform for three variables, okay, L0 T1, the local time at T1, the time spent positive and the time spent negative. Okay, so T1 ds indicator bs positive minus c squared over 2 integral 0 to t1 ds indicator bs negative. Okay, so okay, it is not very complicated to obtain the following result, that this is cosh b plus 2a plus c over b shine b to the power minus 1. Okay, so how do you or how can you get this kind of results? Again, I have presented this as I think is most natural. We could present it just in terms of local times, but okay, let me just give a little, an argument which allows you to obtain this result. So probably the most natural way to do this is to look for a function f such that f of bt and then exponential minus a L0 t minus b squared over 2 integral 0 to t ds indicator bs positive, etc., etc., okay, is a martingale. Okay, so you look, okay, this is the, I mean, since Dube's book, this is really the program which people have been, I mean, people in probability have been following. Look for a martingale to obtain the Laplace transforms of important quantities. Okay, so you have this exponential, etc., and you look for a function of Brownian motion. Maybe this will not be enough. You could have bt, L0 t, etc. Anyway, you have to be a little clever. But essentially, things like this are going to work, and this is a martingale version of the Feynman-Kac formula, so to speak. Okay, and so assume you have found f, then you apply Dube's optional sampling theorem at time t1. Okay, at t1. I mean, so provided you can do that. So when you do that, what do you get? Well, you get that here you will get f of 1 exponential minus a L0 t1, etc., etc. And on the other side, you will have the value at 0. So what you get is that e to the minus a L0 t1 dot 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 equals f of 0 divided by f of 1. Okay? And in this particular case, this is exactly what you get. Okay, now let me remind you that we are very close to formulae which Rod was talking about and showing us previously. And so for instance, let me take A equals C equals 0, okay? So A equals C equals 0, then what we get is e to the minus b squared over 2 integral 0 to t1 ds indicator bs greater than or equal to 0, and we obtain that this is 1 over cosh b. Okay? Alright. So we have, of course we have seen this previously in many ways, but now okay, let us look at the Reinheit theorem here. Okay, so we know that, okay, what is this? This is the integral between 0 and 1. Okay, this quantity is precisely the integral between 0 and 1 of dy ly t1. Okay, I'm just writing this as the integral of the local times between levels 0 and 1. Okay, and Reinheit theorem, the Reinheit theorem tells me by just changing y into 1 minus x that this is distributed as okay x squared plus y x squared. Okay, and so we are exactly back to the quantity which Rod was looking at. Okay, so this is also e of e to the minus b squared over 2 integral from 0 to 1. Okay, let us say dx x squared, and okay, I could write plus yx squared, but okay, I don't do this, I write squared, okay, because x and y are identically distributed and independent. Okay, so you see that, maybe you have been looking at this Laplace transform, and you have found that this is very striking. It looks very much like quantities I have been looking at when I was working up to, let us say, time 1 with the integrals of square of Brownian motion, okay, and Brownian motion itself. So, by the way, L0 T1, okay, is distributed jointly as x1 squared plus y1 squared, okay, which is an exponential variable, but this is the value, okay, at time 1 of the square of Brownian motion. So I could have focused on the two-dimensional Laplace transform. Okay, so this is a coincidence, so to speak, but I mean, this has been perfectly well understood for a long, long time, okay, that you could find Lévy's real formula into very different disguise, involving essentially time spent positive and time spent negative up to T1. Okay? There are some, so I would now like to go into territory which is maybe not so well understood. Yes, excuse me.
It might be a complicated question, but suppose we took the thing to minus a half, so in effect we deconvolve this joint Laplace transform. Does that change the nature of the objects that you're taking expectations of?
I'm not sure.
So, we look at the thing in the brackets to the power minus a half.
Yes, yes.
Does that change the nature of what's inside the letter?
Right. Rod. Okay, my translation of your question is the following. I think that you are asking, do we have an understanding, you are asking consciously or not maybe, but do we have an understanding of xx squared and yx squared separately when we separate, somehow if we break up the local times into, okay, so I think what you are asking is, is there a Reinheit theorem which would involve only square of Brownian motion, square of one-dimensional Brownian motion? The answer is yes. There are extensions with any square Bessel process. Okay, and I could discuss about this. Maybe I will leave it aside, but thank you for this question. It's it is not at all obvious, in fact, to do this separation. Okay.
But there's a sense in which if one takes this to the power minus a half, it's a deconvolution in the whole plane.
Okay.
Because you can think of them as the product of two Laplace transforms, mm-hmm, so mm-hmm. It's just the sum of two, in the plane.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Okay. I'm not sure I understand 100%, but I think you are going into this direction, splitting and understanding better the contributions. Okay, so maybe more modest coincidences have been noticed or have been arising from the physics, some physics literature, in particular with a radius of gyration. Okay, so I will give you an example, so other coincidences. Okay, it has been noticed that I'm giving a fairly general presentation, but I will simplify very soon. So that the integral of the square of Brownian motion minus an integral, okay, so dt f prime t bt squared, okay, and I will very soon take f of s equals s, okay, so it will be even much simpler, is equal in law to integral 0 to 1 ds bs minus f of s b1, okay, squared. And the main example which physicists have been discussing is really f of s equals s. So here you recognize a very well-known representation of the standard Brownian bridge, okay, bs minus sb1. That's a very important representation of the Brownian bridge. And then here, in that case, you just have integral 0 to 1 dt bt, okay, just the integral, okay, maybe I just write it simply like this, integral 0 to t, 0 to 1 dt bt, and here simply little s, okay? So the integral of the square of the Brownian bridge has the same distribution as the integral of the square of Brownian motion to which you have subtracted its integral. Okay, so here, if you are thinking about random variables, you are looking here at the variance of Brownian motion, and you are saying that the variance of Brownian motion is distributed as the integral of the square of the bridge. Okay, so you understand in which way I mean variance. I think of S gives BS as a random variable. Okay, indexed by time between 0 and 1. Why is that? Okay, and of course we know the joint Laplace transform. Okay, so expectation e to the minus lambda squared over 2 dot 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 is again lambda over sine lambda to the 1/2. Okay, the Laplace transform in lambda squared over 2 of the integral of the square of the bridge. Okay, now, so this may be explained, in fact, in a rather simple way, which I call Fubini's theorem. Okay, Fubini's theorem, explained by a Fubini argument. Okay. In fact, I had a lot of difficulties to publish this paper because the referee said, you know, my dear man, Fubini's theorem has been known for a long time. I said, you know, I'm not trying to prove Fubini's theorem, I'm just trying to give a Fubini argument to some identities which are which are a little puzzling. But anyway, so I was very... a little annoyed with this reaction. Anyway, where he was right is that he or she was right is that the Fubini argument is very simple, okay? Because it's the following. Consider two independent Brownian motions, okay, B and C. Independent Brownian motions, and integrate a function, a deterministic function, phi of u and s. Okay. Use Fubini. There is absolutely no problem in using Fubini. Okay, DCS, integral 0 to 1, dbu, and then phi of u and s. All right. Now, you say that, okay, if I condition with respect to C, what am I looking at? I am looking at a Gaussian with a centered Gaussian with variance, okay, so centered Gaussian with variance integral 0 to 1 du, and then integral 0 to 1 dcs phi of u and s squared. Okay? And here I do the same thing, but I condition with respect to B. I am looking at a centered Gaussian with variance, integral 0 to 1 ds, integral 0 to 1 dbu, phi of u and s squared. Okay? But now you pretend you are a little magician and you say, well, okay, after all, these are just Brownian motions, so why don't I use the same notation? So b equals c. Okay, and so what this proves in just these two lines, what this proves is that integral from 0 to 1 of du, integral from 0 to 1 of dbs, phi of u and s squared, okay, is equal in law to integral from 0 to 1 du, integral from 0 to 1 dbs, and now phi of s and u squared. Okay, so that you have changed the role of the variables. Okay, so you have phi of u and s and phi of s and u, and what you are saying is that the integral, the quadratic functionals associated to these two functions, okay, phi and phi tilde, have the same distribution. Okay? And it is exactly this kind of elementary change which explains this kind of identity. Okay? So I can give you the explicit explicit choice you have to make. Okay, so phi of s and u is equal to indicator u smaller than or equal to s minus f of 1 minus f of u indicator indicator su in 0 1 square. Anyway, so very, very, very simple function will give you this result. Okay, and okay, so f of u equals u. This is even simpler. Okay, and I would like to continue on this. I mean, exactly in the same spirit, to give some explanation of another coincidence which had been noticed for a long time. Very interestingly. The corresponding paper was published, I think, in 1962 by Sieselski and Taylor, so very much contemporary to Ray and Knight's papers. So the Sieselski-Taylor identities are the following. They look at the time spent by a Brownian motion in dimension delta plus 2 up to infinity, okay, so ds indicator, okay, b delta plus 2 s, so this is delta plus 2 dimensional Brownian motion, and I look at the time it spends in the unit ball, okay, and what they have shown by computations of the Laplace transforms is that this has the same law as the first eating time of the sphere of radius 1 by Brownian motion with two dimensions less, okay, so b delta, okay. So the first eating time of the sphere by b delta is distributed as the full time spent in the ball of unit 1 by b delta plus 2. Okay? And there, despite quite a lot of ingenious transformations and so on, and better and better knowledge, etc., etc., about Brownian motion, except in the case delta equals 1, where there is a time reversal argument, which gives this result. One has not been discovering some simple proof of this. So what I tried again is I said, okay, let us look at both sides as integrals of local times, but of the norms, okay, of the Bessel processes. That's the norms of these Brownian motions. Okay, so. If you do this, then you can write on the left-hand side integral 0 to 1 of dA, okay, LA, now up to time infinity for this Bessel process with dimension delta plus 2. Okay, so by Bessel process, I only mean the norm of Brownian motion with dimension delta plus 2.
But it would also hold for non-integers.
Yes, and it also holds for non-integers, okay. Yes. And, okay, on the right-hand side, I write this as integral from 0 to 1 of dA Lt1 for r delta at level A, okay? So now, of course, a very trivial situation or explanation would be that both these processes have the same distribution, okay, as A varies. But this is not true, okay? This is completely wrong. But you can explain, okay. So this is correct. But so we have this, okay. So, but you can explain this identity in law because there is a Reinheit theorem for each of these two processes, and I am going to give at least one case, and then we have a kind of a Fubini argument, or I should say integration by parts, which explains exactly what is going on. So this is discussed in chapter 4 of this little book of aspects of Brownian motion. So I have to give two results. One is extension of the Reinheit theorems for these Bessel processes, and the second, the integration by parts formula. Okay, so extension of Reinheit. So, as I have no time to give it completely, but so I will take delta equals 2, and so delta plus 2 equals 4, okay? So, LA T1 of for R2, A between 0 and 1, is distributed as A times the norm of two-dimensional Brownian motion, so B2, taken at log 1 over A, okay? And you take the norm squared, okay? So A between 0 and 1. And for 4, okay, so for 4, LA at infinity, R4, smaller than or equal to 1, is distributed as, okay, 1 over, I have to be careful because I'm looking at a general statement, 2A, norm of, it's a Brownian bridge in this case. I have to be careful. So B tilde A okay square. Okay, where B tilde is a Brownian bridge. Okay. So as you see, what I have to do is to compare the two the two integrals between 0 and 1. Not sure. I don't think it's the Brownian bridge, actually. I think there is a mistake somewhere. So I need to convince you that 1/2, why is it true that 1/2 integral 0 to 1 dA over A, and I can take one dimensional Brownian motion by independence, and then B A squared equals in law to integral 0 to 1 dA A B log 1 over A squared. Okay, so I think this at least makes sense. So I have been considering this identity in law, and I have looked at it in the particular case where we have this. Now, notice that dA over A is the differential of log of 1 over A, okay? And 2A is the differential of A squared, okay? D of log 1 over A, okay? So this is maybe minus dA over A, and d of A squared is 2A dA. Okay, why do I write such simple things? Well, this is because there is this general integration by parts formula, which is the following. And of course, I won't need this generality, but this is how we can understand. So there is an integration, integration by parts. But again, I'm still thinking about this referee. So it's not as trivial or elementary as one may think, and I will explain. So there is the following identity. Take A and B, integral from A to B, and take F to be decreasing, G to be increasing. Okay? Then there is the following. It will be a general identity in law, okay, where on the left-hand side I have minus df of x, b squared, g of x, plus f of b squared, g of b. This is a kind of a boundary term. Okay. On the right-hand side, I have g of a, b squared, f of a, plus integral from a to b of dg of x, b squared, f of x. Okay. So this is what I call this integration by parts formula. But you see, this is an identity in law between two quadratic functionals of Brownian motion. So as far as integration by, deterministic integration by parts formula is concerned, you can take moments. You can take the nth moment on both sides. And this gives you a certain identity, which really comes from classical or elementary integration by parts. Okay, but what I am trying to say here is that behind this identity in law, there are infinitely many integration by parts identities in the trivial sense of the term. Okay, to prove this, you can use the Fubini argument. Okay, very very simply. So that is, you bring in by force on both sides Brownian motion which is independent of B, and you try to write a double integral as I was writing before with phi and phi tilde. Anyway, after some little effort, you arrive to this identity, and then now it is very simple to convince you that this is true, okay, because g, so my function g, of course, will be a squared, and at zero, this takes the value zero, and my function f will be log of 1 over a, okay, which is a decreasing function, which at 1 is equal to 0. Okay? So the boundary terms here are not feature, okay? And we find ourselves with the identity in log between the two integral terms, and these two integral terms are exactly those. Okay? So this gives some explanation of the Sizensky-Taylor identities. Now, of course, you can argue, you can criticize and say, well, but you have been using the Reinheit theorems, which after all are deep theorems and so on. I don't know how to answer this. I just tried to have some to have some sort of understanding of these identities. And I also want to point out for Rod and other people which may fall on such coincidences that maybe one should not be too astonished by them, because there are many examples of pairs k and k prime in K2 with the notations at the beginning of my lecture which have the same distribution. Okay? And maybe one explanation for this is this Fubini, one very kind of baby explanation for this, maybe this Fubini argument. Okay, so thank you very much.